It's been a few days. Figure I'd pop on here and chime in because Oklahoma going to Omaha. It's not just lady stickball doing well, men's stickball, you know, pulling off a few upsets, beating Florida in regionals, beating Virginia Tech in super regionals. Now you're in the top eight and you're in a bracket with Texas, Texas A&M, and Notre Dame, and Tennessee getting upset. So I know it's a trend for like number one teams to never win this thing, but you never expect, you never go in predicting it, mind you, but here we are. OU's got as good a chance as anyone, in my opinion. So definitely we'll be keeping an eye on that. But congratulations to Skip Johnson and that entire roster. Watch them this weekend, and fantastic. Some amazing defensive plays, especially outfield by Pettis. Oh, my God. Don't kill yourself, young man. Anyway, so I'm very late to the party on this because I didn't want to distract from softball. I wanted to be happy last week. I wanted to talk about, you know, winning a national championship. I wanted to keep positive, but I got to talk about this. Like, cause last week he started talking again because he has to have an interview like every month or every couple weeks, it seems, to validate, you know, why he did what he did. And so good old Tebow has a sit down interview. And because everyone's got to like, once again, they got to get their affirmation. They got to validate. They got to make themselves feel better. They got to feel better about themselves. But what went down? Because he left a premier job for another premier job. Because, you know, he wanted a challenge or whatever. But now he's basically backhanding his former players here, and then that's where I got a problem with that. Because everyone says, "Did you hear what he said? Did you hear what he said?" It's like, you know what? I'm just gonna ignore it. I don't want to talk about it. I want to focus on these things, but you know, just, you can't help yourself, unfortunately. Just when I thought I was out, they pulled me back in. So he goes on about going to the playoff. He's gone into four playoffs at OU. One as a coordinator, three as a head coach. And he goes to talk about, I've walked in there. I'm paraphrasing, mind you. I've at best had the third best roster, this and that, and talks about how at USC, how he can build a roster that can win a national title, all these things. So, let's back out for a moment. Insinuating you've walked into the playoff with, at best, the third best roster. He's probably right. I think the time you were the third best roster, probably the Rose Bowl against Georgia. I mean, offensively, nine of those guys, NFL players. All NFL players. I think the only two guys that didn't really, I think maybe Dimitri Flowers and then Eric Wren was our starting center, because I think Creed Humphrey was redshirting at the time. So, yeah. Defensively, you had Oboe. Kenneth Murray was still young. So, okay, Steve Parker I liked, but, like, you know, let's just be honest here. Defense was not great. It hasn't been great for a long time. But you walked in there, you're basically making more excuses for your failures. Because that's what you did. You failed. No matter how you try to spin it, no matter how you try to, you know, create this narrative of why you did what you did, you failed at Oklahoma. And the more we get further away in this, the more comfortable people feel about talking about him, how he really felt about being there. I don't think he enjoyed being there. I mean, just his body language and the way he wasn't a very, like, you know, upfront person. He's very guarded. And I'm fine with people being guarded as long as they, you know, take care of business. And for the most part, he did. But his teams were weak. They were soft at the end of the day. And they were slowly eroding each season. And he never had to pay for those crimes. Crimes meaning he never had to feel the backlash of failing for a year where people thought this team could win a national title. He never had to own up to that because he created a bigger story by going out west, being the bitch that he is. So, and, you know, the reason I'm talking about this now as opposed to last week, because I listened to Gabe and Teddy on the Oklahoma Breakdown, and they made a good point because they felt they had to talk about it. And it made a really good point. So, like, how many, the Clemson teams that have won national titles recently, a lot of good players, a lot of elite players, mind you. Did they have the best roster top to bottom every time they played in the national championship game or won the national championship. Again, a lot of good players, but did they have the best roster on paper, top to bottom? Probably not, especially those earlier teams. Oklahoma, when they went up to Ohio State and Columbus and won, didn't have the best roster top to bottom. They didn't. Add to the fact, CeeDee Lamb was a freshman. Hollywood Brown wasn't a factor yet. He didn't become like a... People didn't know who he was till Bedlam later that year. Mark Andrews injured his knee early in that game. So who did he have to throw to again? He had... I believe he had his high school teammate who was a walk-on. I think Rodney was playing. Like, all the top-tier guys you associate with that 2017 that Baker threw, they were not on the field. That was a big... You had Jordan Smallwood and a bunch of guys. So, did you have the best roster then? You're able to pull it off then. Here's another question. When Bob Stoops won a national title in 2000, did he have the best roster? Hell no, he did not have the best roster. He had the best coach team. I think that's where... This is where we're getting to here. Ability to coach up your team, develop your players. Because that roster that won a title... was on some of the worst... Those seniors, those upperclassmen, were on some of the worst OU teams ever. Ever. This has been a consistently winning program since 1947. Post-World War II, the winningest program ever. Like, winningest program. No question. Like, the dip in the 90s, yeah. But after that, consistently winning double-digit games every year. So, don't sit here and tell me... as an excuse that, well, we walked in there with like the third or fourth, but like, don't sit here and tell me you have to have the best roster, because that's a load of crap. And if you want to point to like, well, 2000 was a long time ago in a different era, you're absolutely right it was. But you know what? In the, like, on the field against Florida State, they had, I guarantee you, they had the Snoop Minnis or not, they had the better roster. They had Anquan Boldin on that field. How'd he do in the NFL? I don't want to, for a second, think about lowering the bar, lowering the standards, just because you were unable to accomplish your goal, or to try to act like that it's hard to recruit to Oklahoma, or it's impossible to win at a high level at Oklahoma. I don't want to hear that trash. See, that's what USC got now. If you may be all excited and you know, oh my God, we're getting all these big time recruits. Yeah, that was us too, especially on offense. Oh, you guys getting the flashy quarterbacks and the receivers, and you know, it's going to be a lot of fun. It's going to look great at some points. Maybe this year might be a little rough, but next year and beyond, I think you're going to be regular contenders in the Pac-12. But here's the thing. If you think for a moment that he's going to lead you to the promised land based on the way he's talking, he can very well easily do it to you. Because he talked about how it's like, you know, no, oh, everyone's going to have, you know, hard feelings if you don't retire there. Like, listen, no grown-up on this planet, and I emphasize grown-up, no grown-up thought that he was going to be at OU forever. I thought that if he won a national title, the clock began ticking, and it was going to be a short clock. It's like, he won a title, he did it. If he goes off to the NFL, I have no hard feelings. You brought us a championship. That's what I thought was eventually going to happen. But that didn't happen. And it got a little harder and a little harder and a little harder. And like the results just very subtly got a little worse, a little worse, a little worse. And I think he saw the writing on the wall that he was incapable of bringing home a championship at Oklahoma. So now he's going to lie to himself saying, well, if I go to USC and I can get all these California recruits I've been getting lately and just do it there, well, I could just... If you think it's going to be that simple with Alex Grinch as your D coordinator, wish you the best of luck. I mean, Cowherd could talk you up all you want. That's fine. But I just want to get that off my chest real quick, because I just think it's really kind of disgusting that you, under the radar, being the undercover cunt that he is, would like just basically backhand his football players and try to give full blame. Because if you were a real head coach, Bob Stoops never put blame on his players. He always took the blame. He always took sole responsibility. It was his job to get the team ready. And Bob failed miserably lots of times when people thought he was going to win. But he always took responsibility. It was always on him. the gall to, like, oh, third or fourth, like, who's responsible for that roster? Mostly you. So don't you dare, like, insult your players or backhand them like that in the media just because you're getting your ass kicked by Dan Lanning at Oregon because he's negatively recruiting against you. Because guess what? No matter how you try to spin it, the truth is you ran because you failed and you knew you couldn't get the job done. That's all I have to say on that, Boomer Sooner. We'll see what happens in recruiting this week. Keep an eye on baseball. Wish all the boys best of luck going to Omaha. Congrats, Skip, and that team. Fantastic job. Go get yourself a ring. You've earned it. Boomer Sooner.